Any other questions with Mark and his group lab, but hopefully no other questions on the audit. We're all good there. Good. All right, we're a few minutes ahead of schedule, which is always good. Let's go ahead and move into finance. Stephanie?
All right. If you recall the last couple of years, what I've done is kind of been a comparison of where we are at 6 months through this budget year versus last year. Last year, I also added in 2010, which was the last year before the economy kind of turned, just as a comparison. And it kind of gives you a good idea of where we are in comparison to last year, but you also have to remember that there's some things that change as well. But it will kind of tell you where, because there's so many things that some things happen early in the year, some happen later, so it's always a good indicator of where things should be. This year I did something a little bit different as well. What I've done before is only put departments that have people or actual personnel in them. You have everything in here this year, so there's some things in here that are really for informational purposes only. But they, if you actually went back to the financials, they would add up to everything. Looking on the first page there, under the general fund, property taxes, and I won't go through all of this, but if you have questions, please let me know. You'll see the very first line there, property tax. If you look at this year compared to last year, 89.34% versus 55.21%. You'll remember last year there was a delay in property taxes, and that made the difference on that. But if you look back at 2010, we were at 82.45% there. A couple of other items under taxes. We kind of talked about this, and I have a slide on that later as well. I know Harrison's going to talk about it. The title ad valorem tax, that has decreased from this time last year. The industrial and recreation, those were done at year end. But if you look at your local option sales tax, even looking back at 2010, that has just continued to decrease each of those years that we're looking at. Right now we're at $5.8 million. We were at $6 million in 2010.
And because of that?
Well, there's a lot of changes. There's a lot of things that have changed in that. The motor vehicles was a big part of that, but it is still continuing to decline for some reason. We've talked about a lot of different things, but it kind of has gone up and down. And there's not an explanation for why it goes up and down like it does. But overall, it seems to just be declining every year.
We've said it used to be that we could follow that pattern, and it was on a cycle. And we could pretty much tell you what time of year these sales were taking place or not taking place. That hasn't been following the pattern over the last 4 or 5 years at least. It's just random. 1 month we're up, maybe up 2 months in a row, and then now we're down for 3 or 4, or down 1, or jump back up. There's no rhyme or reason to it. So if you got a guess, it's probably as good as I'll as to why. Is we've asked at state level, the chairman has talked to our delegation and said what seems to be going on, and apparently they are as befuddled as everybody else. The state's revenue continues to climb. And those of you that participated at the Rotary program several months ago and listened to the comments made by the delegation showing how much money the state is bringing in, that money is not trickling. For whatever reason,
so it's not showing up back down in the block. They got $2 billion.
Yeah, go from 250,000 to 2 billion.
That's what I remember. And you talk with the folks from the Department of Revenue, and their typical answer is, "Well, we return what we receive." Which there's something. There's a problem somewhere. There has to be.
lots of analysis, that's the best guess, it's a couple of factors that could play in the allows for the take.
Good, Mark, thank you.
If you look over on page two, under your charges for focus, and all of us lot of those as well, animal shelter, for some reason, that is declining as well. And then some of these vary, like the culverts under public works, that's mainly culvert installations, and that just varies depending on who's making those requests. Just a couple of, they're very small, but just a couple of notable things. Our bad check fees are almost nothing anymore, which is a good thing. State courts, pre-court fines, those are down from last year. They look like they were going up last year, but they're not really moving up. And then a lot of that also depends on where those are as far as coming from the clerk's office as well, because sometimes there's a delay in getting those in. Over on page four, we start the revenues for funding expenditures for the general fund. Just a note, because of the way the general fund falls, there's actually 14 pay periods in the first half of the year. Now, once we get to the end of the year, we kind of originally accrued by day, so it'll even out for the year. But it looks like the personnel is a little bit higher during the first half of the year just because of that extra pay period getting. Down towards the middle of the page, you have the services for the county attorney there. The fluctuation in those depends on what kinds of things are going on and what the watch of sales tax or SDS are going on. Those are generally higher than where they normally would be. Just a couple of notes about some of the changes. If you look, for instance, at the county clerk on the bottom of page four, in 2010, that was at 48.10%. Now it has about 65%. That's the countywide website, which is paid early in the year. The same thing over on page five, if you look at the bottom there, under human resources, they were at 49% in 2010. They run about 80% now, halfway through the year. That's because of a property and casualty premium that's paid early.
So basically, they're just front-loaded expenditures.
Right. Right. So there's a lot of things like that. There's information on every department in here. If you have, I'll go through all of these, but if you have specific questions about me. And then I have some charts at the end that will show some of this information as well. Over on page 10, under the Sheriff's Department, and we have some information about this later in the presentation as well. That is a little bit higher this year. If you look at the services and contracts line, their medical costs are running way ahead this year.
And certainly that goes possibly well if we say, taking additional prisoners. Anyone that goes to jail would have to provide medical services.
But the sheriff is already making some changes there. He has already changed, or he's in the process of changing the medical contract, which is going to save, I believe it's only $400,000 a year. So he's already made some of those changes, or he's in the process of making those changes.
You're right. Those.
I mean, I've heard about the say like if you pick up on those illegals, not illegals, immigrants, and house them in our jail, you have to feed them, but you also got to provide medical services too until they get that. You can pay for work, right? Well, that's what I've seen.
Yeah, they have some medical related issues, certainly. They have the responsibility of the agency that arrested them until they become a county prisoner. In case of the city would be responsible for, or cities would be responsible for that medical cost until that inmate is transferred as a county inmate, as opposed to only a municipal inmate. Did we incur that expense?
What's the timeline on that process typically? I know it might be different from one case to another case.
The blink of an eye.
24 hours. So they have to be murdered within 24 hours.
They turn them over to us instantly.
And if anybody slips through, they call it today's for the next month, and then they'll subtract that back off of.
Well, I mean, that's just the way the system is everywhere.
Yeah.
It's not just Lowndes. I mean, it's not something
we're not creating.
Okay. I mean, automatically, just as soon as the municipalities release that prisoner to the county for the most part and get the paperwork done, he's a county prisoner at that point.
If you were on the other side of the ledger, you'd be doing the same thing.
Right.
As if they can convert the state charges.
Right. Okay.
These sort of immigrants who are criminals.
These are I'm talking about anybody in general.
Commissioner Marshall was referencing immigrants, but the conversation is just in general, anybody.
It doesn't matter whether you're an immigrant or what have you. The issue with the illegal immigrants is a little bit, it's a concern because we don't know how much it's going to escalate. I haven't seen anything from the standpoint of how local governments would be reimbursed for the expenses involved in holding the illegal immigrants. The number right now relative to the state of Georgia is fairly small, but it's very early too on what they're beginning to talk about. And so I think you're going to find jurisdictional leaks. They'll be making some decisions about how to address those concerns. Now, certainly, illegal immigrant that commits a criminally type situation, yeah, you probably go directly to jail and get in the process, and then then the ICE will begin to determine what your fate is, you might say. But then you've got the ones that just goes to a traffic stop, license check or something, and they get caught. That could be a whole different argument.
Yeah, it used to be that the big driver in medical care in prisons, and it may still be, was mental health issues. There are psychotic drugs that are extremely expensive, and usually that means the county has to pay for it. I don't know if that's continued, whether mental health services picked up. The reason those people are getting picked up is they're have done some sort of crime or homeless because of their schizophrenia or whatever, and then they end up in prison, and then all the drugs and everything they need have become public capital.
Can you say something about the legislation at the state house that you have to renew your prescription every week that's getting proposed or something like that?
For mental health patients, I'm not aware of it, but
I think they say EHD and different of them, but it's being considered at the state house. And they're trying to, they say, home in on those who abuse opioids. So
right. And that's fine.
They do it every week.
They need to be aware that those people have to return to their physician for those prescriptions. You don't just automatically renew them. Mm-hmm. And it wouldn't surprise me if they don't understand that. Because they have to be assessed continually to make sure that the drug they're being given is meeting the need.
I think that's part two of what Superior Court Judge Jameson and his staff are trying to address through the Mental Health Accountability Court. I know Commissioner Garner has a significant amount of information on that, but that they are identifying those people as early as possible, trying to get them out of jail, out on their own, and through that process, because then they're responsible for their own, and a lot of them qualify for Medicaid.
I just seen the announcement last week. It's a new event proposed to cause happens after the prescriptions renew every week, so versus monthly.
Starting over on page 12, because we have a lot of your outside agencies, and we
for the general fund, it's mainly due to that delay in property taxes. KLBD was for information only. Over on page 16, I'm still working with the sheriff's department trying to figure out what is going on with their commissary revenues. But other than that, the commissary is running about where it normally lived this time of year. The next couple of pages were for information only. Over on page 19, these are hotel motel fund. There are a lot of changes in this fund from what was happening last year. As of August 1st, the hotel motel rate changed to 7%. And that also changed how we pay out those funds. You have 1 cent going to the conference center now, and you have an additional cent that goes to tourism. But we moved the airport out of this fund instead of transferring funds from the special services fund to cover it. We transferred funds from hotel motel back to special services and use that to pay for part of the airport. But none of those funds, or the change in the hotel motel, because that was effective for the month of August, those funds weren't due until September 20th, so there's a delay in seeing some of that.
Okay, just clarification. The hotel motel tax is 7% that we collect from the incorporated areas of Lowndes County. Still does not cover the contribution that we make to the airport authority.
That's correct.
So we do still have to supplement that out of the general fund.
Well, out of the special services fund.
I mean, special services fund, correct. Okay.
Okay. Over on page 20 and 21 is your intergovernmental grant fund. And just some of the notes in here, there are a lot of new grants as far as your accountability court and your DUI court and your B grant that were not in there or that have started in the last year. Over on page 23, you'll see the jail operations fund. If you look at the five revenues there for state court, superior court, and even for municipal court, you'll see how those have declined over the years. And those have just continued to, and that's something that we talk about every year at the retreat. And however this fund ends up, at the end of the year, you cover the difference. Mostly, mainly with the electricity out of the general fund.
Significant part of this, and y'all will hear more about this when we get into the budget review. The comments from all of the courts that I have heard from, and Stephanie's heard from, is a request for additional funding. Contrast between those requests for additional funding and the decline in revenue. Increases that they are looking for are not small.
Does this move to group games and people not get in trouble?
No. Just one.
Are you saying that same amount of people get in trouble?
Our awareness increase, thanks, Blake.
Every one of them has commented to me about the main cause of additional. And that up until recently, I think in almost every one of those fines and fees have been continually dropped as this indicates. Now, apparently, I think there may be some efforts on behalf of the Sheriff's Department to try to increase patrolling in areas, but that, as you know, is not a revenue producer from the standpoint. That's not the purpose of law enforcement to be a revenue producer. And the courts have all indicated to me that they're not revenue producers either. And Apparently, they're correct.
So, the courts are not collecting the fines that should be collected?
No, the amount is reduced.
Reducing the fines?
For whatever reason, we have a higher caseload from all the courts by their, but the revenue is not part of the school.
And part of that started with the decline in the economy, because initially you had more people that were going on probation because they couldn't pay those fines, so we saw an increase in probation. Well, whenever they're paying probation fees and all of those reporting fees and some of the evidence-based programs that are involved in that, then that's less of the fine that actually eventually makes its way to the county. Then, to keep from having to put so many people on probation, you saw the trend of the fine amounts for a particular incident start to decrease, so that there was a balance there. So it's kind of like the healthcare situation. There's trends to it, and you know, when one trend starts to get too heavy, you see an adjustment made, and then it, you know, turns the corner and it's handled in a way.
You may have said it in one term, and what I see a lot of times is that when a judge imposes a fine, there's a certain amount of mandated carve-outs also out of that fine that has to come out and go somewhere else. So when you get to the end of the day, there's so really there's just a smaller piece that's left for the county to get it with.
Yeah, those add-ons are not add-ons.
That's right.
Yeah, because there's a base fine and they subtract it. They don't add them to it.
Yeah.
And then charge the person more. The other thing I want to comment on is they give me case file data for capital. And what they're saying to some degree is showing up, like the Superior Court criminals, Scott, he went from 3,915 cases to 5,384 in last year. But the other courts are all about the same. So I would certainly inquire as to what their current data is. And I would also encourage the use of a better technology as opposed to personnel.
Well, I'm getting that.
Getting both.
We can just get 100% of it.
Starting on page 25 is your emergency communication fund. This is another fund that they do have increased number of calls, increased workload, and every year you can see the difference in the request that the general fund supplements for this fund. Over on page 29 is your risk and witness. Again, if you look there under your filings for the Church under State and Superior Court, you can see that continuing decline in those filings. Over on page 30 on expenditures, you can see back in 2010, the Haven was also funded out of this. This fund did not the district attorney and the solicitor with funds that they needed, so that was taken out. And last year, because of the decline in fines, both of those departments took a decrease. The district attorney took an additional decrease to help the victim witness maintain a part-time position. But that fund at this point, because of the decrease in fines, is looking about where it was in 2010, mid-year.
So when you're saying increasing fines, we're just saying that something's changed where they don't get the full amount of fines.
They're not getting the same amount that they have.
Same case, so I guess a positive change is something that got a different parts of the way versus not used to.
Well, whatever that revenue is, has declined.
What? Correct me if I just maybe I misheard this, but if I heard what Harrison said, the caseload is actually going up, but the fines are actually coming down.
Yeah,
Certainly in spirit.
Right.
And keep in mind, the judges do have discretion. Part of the problem is, do I find this person and they can't pay it, put them in jail, $45 a day?
Right.
Or do I lower their fine and you work pre-probation to get that money? So I think what you're seeing is the judges trying to get the right balance. So at the end of the day, the county, what you're not measuring is how much it would cost you to have that person in prison and not get it collected by the anyways.
So you're saying it's the judge's discretion to get the full amount of fine versus
why?
Starting on page 31 is your special services fund. That is your unincorporated revenues and unincorporated services. That fund continues to be healthy. Over on page 37, that is your current SWAS. And we will note that these SWAS revenues are down from last year at the same point.
Harrison, would you comment? You may have it later on in your presentation, but the adjustment. That revenue continues to decline, or has declined on SWAS revenue, how that impacts those projects?
The way we track it is we put in the actual amounts as they come in. So if they're declining, that automatically re-estimates all your projects that we have put under the variable category, meaning they can go up or down. Each takes a hit, whether it be roads, water, sewer, there's a whole collection. You have some outside funds for recreation and other things that are fixed. You guarantee that they're going to stay where they are.
This is a problem we faced in previous SPLOS because of this decline, then having to go in one particular case to the airport and say the revenue we anticipated you receiving, you're not going to receive it because it's not there. Well, we need it. Well, I understand, but we don't have it. So, and that, what we're trying to do now is, as Harrison described, trying to address those that are fixed costs versus those that are variable costs.
And so is that why the proposed budget number, for example, for the 911 center was actually different than what we actually had budgeted in the original SPLOS referendum? Was that adjustment would have
yes.
been made?
Yes.
That's
correct.
So everything comes down, it's not like you get to the end and the last project don't get anything.
No,
everything just gets reduced.
We learned that the last loss, you can't do that.
Right.
And if we had done that, you would have ended up not having money to pay back the bonds. And that's why we track it that way, so that we're telling people, and I'm sending out reports, at least four, to say, hey, your road funds probably aren't as what you thought they were. Your 911, a lot out to Chad because he oversees a lot of the building projects and trying to convince him that that probably was what he
thinks. But also the risk that you run in a situation like that is, and I'll use the same analogy with the 911 center, if you get ready to build that project and it, I'm trying to remember, let's just say it was $800,000, that's what you had budgeted, but yet it's going to come in at $800,000. But yet, because of the formula, you're back down to $750,000 maybe, or even $700,000. You got to find some more money to do that.
You're about back in here.
Yeah.
Well, you're allowed, under SPLOS law, you're allowed to take money out of one project, put it in another.
Okay.
Now, usually what that means is, because roads usually has the largest budget, you're going to end up taking it out of roads unless you have another project that comes in under the estimate. But one way or another, you're going to have
you don't say roads.
Yeah.
Well, if you go back to what you were referring to earlier, the SPLOS in recreation, initially we had put $6 million in there in SPLOS series, and that number was dropping like a rock.
Yeah.
And so they finally wound up estimated $180 million over that time period. We get $150. We've estimated $150 in this loss, thinking it would be at least equal to that. And we, based on what we see right now, we're probably not going to hit $150.
How long would that like to?
I don't want to steal your thing. You'll see the difference in those lighting structures. So we're trying to make a proposal back to y'all that would be reflected that cost to the county.
That's your only fund that's running a deficit. So I encourage you to look at that. If you do something now, I think it would be a small increase. If you keep waiting, it's going to take a significant increase.
They haven't always given it out. They've only started doing that in the last, I guess, 3 years, probably. They did some through a grant and allowed we bought some got a truck for that, and some of the departments bought containers and so forth. So. But we have received money back, to answer your question, and we plow that back in.
Well, that's not a
It really depends on what their decision is. When they look, that board looks at their revenues, and they make a decision as to some type of reimbursement to those participants. And it's really then at that point, based on what the participant brings in tonnage or is responsible for.
But it's more like a grant than a kickback.
Yeah, that's a bad word.
I was listening to a And that is not even to take into account your loss in your sales tax.
So always be cautious about the favors that they're going to do for you.
To make you whole. Is that what we heard? To make us whole.
Yeah.
Okay.
First is whole.
Yeah, it is whole.
Over on page 55, this has to do with prisoner housing. The blue area is jail cost, and this is an estimate of jail cost. Sheriff, I talked about this because there are so many different things that go into that. But overall, you can see that the jail costs have continued to increase. But then you see what happens to prisoner housing. And that has basically, it dropped in 2013 and has been mostly flat or declining. I did talk to the sheriff. Again, he said he is changing the medical contract. He's in the process of that and estimates that I was going to say $300,000 to $400,000. He's also got the work detail back in place, and he said that's going to save another $180,000. And he has moved seven people or seven positions back onto road patrol. So he has a lot of things going that is going to help save some of those costs, get some of those things back where they should be.
Stephanie, can we, and I believe we're going to have a sheriff here this afternoon and ask to come and speak as well. Maybe we can ask him these questions, but as you look at this and you just kind of see all of a sudden it's dropped down at least a third of what it's actually costing us to house the prisoners. Is that what your chart's actually reflecting?
Well,
the revenue versus what it's actually costing us?
You have to look at a different scale on there, but no, it has dropped, and a lot of that dropped, I think, when we were doing local option sales tax and we were doing some of those studies, the prisoners on which ones were municipal versus which ones were county, and a lot of those prisoners started getting turned over faster, but you also had the drops in the prisoner housing rates.
And that's kind of what I'm getting at. I think that we need to be sure. We know what it's costing us to house the prisoner. We need to be also sure that compensation that we get back from other municipalities and or counties, whatever the case may be, that the rate that they're being charged is compensable. With what we're getting and what it's called, our cost is.
We just got some information together for the sheriff, and he said he's going to work on this.
He's going to
proceed.
That decision as to the charge to the municipalities is left to the sheriff.
That's right. And I realize that, and that's what he was saying.
I think he could say he is aggressively moving in that direction. Yes.
Also, keep in mind this county switch where they're taking their prisoners during that time frame. I know the near county did. They moved up to Dolphin. Yeah.
Who's taking the prisoners to Culver?
It was Lanier. May not be called.
Oh, Lanier. Yeah. I knew that they were not bringing their prisoners over here.
And,
I spoke to
them. That was just a result of Coffee County opening a new facility. And anytime you open a new facility, you build it out for way more prisoners than you got. Mm-hmm. Well, the cost of that, because you have to manage, is enormous. So suddenly you got this huge expense and no income. Uh-huh. So they offer great margins on outside prisons. One day they'll get called up.
It's a shame we end up in a competitive market just to have prisoners.
Exactly.
Over on page 56, we have their animal services. The blue area, again, is the cost for animal services. And then what we've seen in the last couple of years is a decline in those revenues. And that's the adoptions and recalls. 657 in our revenues. These are just the general fund funds, but if you look at where your fund revenues were in 2002 compared to now.
There you go.
Page 58. This is a comparison of your revenues and your expenditures. And then the blue line at the top is your fund balance. And then what I did is put in the number of days that you have in there. And in 2009, we changed our policy from 90 to 120 days. We were there for 3 years, and we were pretty close for two. But, you know, we had a few years that were not as good as we hoped. But those are starting to move back up, and we're still not there. But that kind of tells you where we are. But overall, we've maintained that pretty well.
Well, I've been disappointed in not being 120 days for all the reasons that Stephanie and Harrison and Mark have pointed out. I've been extremely pleased that we're as high as we are.
Yeah. I would agree with that, and it's always a concern, and I commend the staff, and I also commend previous commissioners that kind of set that level at that point.
Well, that goes back to mission statement.
That's right. And so again, a great job, and I'm very, very proud of them. I mean, we're still in a tough economic situation right now. We haven't even come close to coming out of it. Some folks have seen some improvement, but as Mr. Gretchen was saying, under the circumstances like it is, we can look here and see the cost of providing government services is continuing to go up. Yet our revenues are continuing to come down or stay flat one or the other. And so just to be able to stay where we're at on that fund balance that speaks strong for the position where it can be.
Yeah, the other thing you have to realize is if the health fund skyrockets, and I'm coming in here and funds out, you're $1 million deficit. We don't just let that sit there. We immediately go back to all the fund. The general fund will get hit the hardest and go carve out and need more dollars out of the general fund. That would probably put you into a deficit for that year and reduce your fund balance. But that's why it's there to help when those cycles bump up and we need somewhere to go. It's not only health, it's retirement too. Retirement is continuing to climb. But you even had some fund balance left in your retirement fund this past year. So there's two areas there that just with the stroke of a pen, you suddenly go from being in black to a year in close out that pushes you into the red. So that's why that's really important.
Okay.
Page
59, we put this in here the last couple of years. But 2010 to 2011, 2011 was the year the reduction in force happened. So there's a comparison each of these, and you have four commissions. That's everything that falls under the board commissions, and you have all of your elected officials where the impact of that reduction in force happened. And then you have a comparison of where we are today from 2010 and where the vast majority of that has not changed. Where does your dollar
go? We can see where the hit's at.
Yeah. I'll be very loud. No.
No. This needs to be like our way of our budget meetings. This needs to be the kind of quite permanently lower.
Where does your dollar go for every dollar of property tax you pay? Where that goes to, 8 cents to the Board of Commissioners and Administration, 1 cent to the Board of Elections, 2 cents for the Tax Commissioner, 3 cents for the Board of Assessors, 2 cents for 3 cents contingency, 13 cents to the courts, 33 cents to the sheriff, 1 cent
$0.15 to Public Works, $0.05 to Industrial, $0.07 to Recreation, and $0.04 to your outside agencies. Then you have a comparison on your expenditure history. The blue is the Board of Commissioners and everything that falls under that. The orange is your elected officials and outside agencies. And then the next several pages are just kind of some graphs of each of those departments to kind of show you where, what, how they have fallen for the last several years at midpoint of year. So what you see is for the most part, they are all pretty much flat. They all are about the same point every year. I only have one slide on here that goes over 100%, and that's the Board of Equalization. They were at 99% once, and they were at 120 plus 2 different years at midpoint of year. But that kind of shows you where everyone is. The there are a few in there that have fluctuations. Like I said earlier, the county attorney, depending on if there's SDS or loss or anything in the elections, has a lot of fluctuation in there.
All right. Commissioners, any questions from this one?
Oh, that's great. Very raise the bar, makes it easier to vote, understand, visualize.
It's just like I said.
Let's do it like all night, how it's playing out.
It continues to improve, and definitely again, thank you. Thank you and your staff and great conference all over that. All right, it's about time for a break. We'll do that. We've got some guests that just joined us. We've got the tax commissioner, Mr. Rodney Kane, and this is a guest.
Yes.
All right, and so let's take a quick break, and then